wait a little bit longer.
We're using my grandson's other electric.
I would like to call to order the October meeting of the Buncombe County Health and Human Services Board. Glad to have everybody here, especially this distinguished looking panel. Glad to have you all with us. We've had a chance to look at the agenda. I'd like to remind you why we're looking at the agenda in accordance with state government act of that duty of every member to avoid both conflicts of interest and appearance of conflict. Have any questions or additions or deletions of the agenda? If not, do I have a motion that we approve the agenda as presented?
So moved.
Moved by, okay. Moved in second, I guess.
There we go.
Take one of those, move in second. Okay, any questions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
So be it. We're, as I indicated, we have a distinguished panel. And boy, y'all look good. But anyway, Lisa, if you will get us started, we appreciate it very much.
Thank you. So we couldn't have set the table any better for this meeting today than what happened late last night as we heard news that another physician who had come back into the country had gotten a fever and had some stomach complaints and had gone to the hospital and in fact had been diagnosed later in the evening with Ebola. It was heartening to hear that the CDC actually had just been to that hospital and had gone through and inspected their protocols and found them to be up to par, that they were very capable and able and ready to handle such a situation just as that. So this topic today couldn't be any more important and any more timely, but it really is about the fact that in Buncombe County we are prepared to handle these kinds of diseases outbreaks. And part of what we wanted to do is we're very fortunate to have your varied Health and Human Services Board. We have our commissioner, Joe Belcher, here today, and we have our county manager, Wanda Green, and we have a very distinguished panel that is representative of the network of agencies that come together during a preparedness situation or an outbreak and work together in coordination to make sure that our community stays safe. I was going to start off by first just going around the room and having the board introduce themselves so that the panel, and then Jennifer's going to introduce them later after I make a few comments.
Great. I'm Candace Toole. I'm a school psychologist for Asheville City Schools.
Paul Hendry, optometrist.
Ken Putnam, transportation department director with the City of Asheville.
Sharon West, Veterans Administration.
Rick Weigel, Mission Psychiatry.
Stephanie Kaiser, Community Benefit Mission Health, the pharmacist representative for the board.
Richard Oliver, veterinary representative, and with North Carolina Department of Agriculture Diagnostic Labs.
Terry Van Dyne, community volunteer.
Suzanne Swanger.
Bill McElroth, I'm retired.
And as all of you know, me, I'm still the assistant county manager as well as the Health and Human Services Director, and Michael Ruth, our attorney. So since 2005, we've strategically been looking at the core services of public health. We've partnered with community agencies, outsourced when possible, and as soon as we've done and entered into those kind of partnerships, we very carefully reinvested back into core services. In public health, we've increased the number of disease control nurses we have, the number of school nurses, the number of environmental health inspectors. And this all allows us to have this robust response when necessary. We've also made sure that we have the infrastructure in place so that we can do the right surveillance, the right containment and treatment to any kind of outbreak that occurs. We recently had in the jail a TB case that they have successfully contained and continue to work on, but our disease control nurses are very, very adept at tracking down contacts and making sure that they contain diseases when they appear. As you know from also our recent board meeting, we had a communication team meeting about immunizations and our immunization campaign, and we invested resources into a strong communication team so that we are educating the community about public health education and making sure that preparedness doesn't start with an outbreak, but rather with hand washing and getting your flu shots and making sure that your immunizations are up to date. So it's a very proactive process that we have in our county. So we want people to have these good lifelong habits, and we want to have them just for these types of circumstances. Dr. Mullendore is going to kick off a panel discussion for us. She is our medical director, and I'm going to let her introduce the panelists. So thank you, Dr. Mullendore.
So like she said, I'm the medical director here at Health and Human Services, and we have Dr. David McClain, who is one of our board members, but also an admission infectious disease doctor. Dr. Chris DeRienzo, who's the Chief Patient Safety Officer at Mission Health. Jacie Volkman, who we're very familiar with in the communicable disease world, who is the Director of Infection Prevention at Mission. And then we have Dennis Presley, who is the Chief of the Skyland Fire Department. Kevan Smith, who's the Public Safety Chief at Asheville Regional Airport. And then our Health and Human Services PIO, Public Information Officer, Jennifer Johnson. And then Sue Ellen Morrison, who's our lead communicable disease nurse in Health and Human Services. We're going to start by have Dr. McClain just talk briefly about Ebola.
Stand up, or
you can do whatever you want.
Okay. So you guys all know about it. You don't want it. So it's named after Ebola River in Congo, Zaire. And previous outbreaks, which have been dated back in the 1970s, were really in isolated parts in Africa, and therefore the outbreaks could be contained really well. To be pedantic, viruses are parasites. They're genetic material that can infect a plant, animal, human cell. They all have their own specificity. We're familiar with what poliovirus does, or a rhinovirus, a cold virus does. Ebola is a filovirus. It causes a syndrome of hemorrhage. And it's not the only virus that could do that. It's not the only infection that can do that. So there's nothing necessarily specific about the disease itself, but what really, really helps, Sue Ellen Morrison will tell you, is to know the epidemiology, where the patient's been from. And remember the fella who died in Dallas, it was from Liberia. He lied on his exit from Liberia about had he been caring for anyone that had Ebola there. And that's exactly what he'd been doing when he was in Monrovia. Unfortunately, this doctor that was diagnosed last evening in New York City, he had the honesty to say, oh, I was in Guinea taking care of Ebola patients just 2 weeks ago. We would call that a smoking epidemiology. I mean, that really heightens your reason for concern. But that's going to be key as you hear other people in this panel talk about how we're going to try to identify somebody. We don't want to be caught in a situation like you did at Presbyterian, where you find out, oh, you know, 2 days later, 4 days later, this patient hemorrhaging in the ICU has a very, very infectious body fluids. So the virus infects people. It causes leak from the small blood vessels, that is the capillaries. They have edema from all this leaking, but they're actually in shock. So the fluid, the intravascular volume is depleted. The brain doesn't like that. The kidneys hate that. They often go into failure. The lungs fill up with fluid, being a respiratory failure. So we call that multi-organ system dysfunction. In a healthy person, you're looking at a mortality easily there of 40, 50%. So that's why you see quoted a mortality of 50%. Interestingly, I found this out. I didn't know this before, that semen can be infectious for up to 5 weeks after infection. That's interesting to think about from an epidemiology standpoint. But any body fluid can be infectious. And so if somebody's hemorrhaging from their nose, from their rectum, they're vomiting, that's a real challenge for caregivers. This is causing great anxiety on the part of caregivers, clinical caregivers, for good reason. And then the laboratory aspect of it requires some careful thought. Also, with JC, and we had some discussions just a week ago, we really probably had to put more thought in that as well. But as far as air transmission, airborne transmission, water, food, no. It really is person-to-person contact. And incidentally, in West Africa, in Africa, in previous outbreaks, there's a tradition in many tribal communities of their wake consists of laying hands on the deceased. Okay? Not part of our culture, but in many African cultures it is. And so that would sustain a lot of transmission before. And so you have to break a cultural norm there before. But obviously that's not the case in Presbyterian Hospital in Dallas, what's going on with transmission there. So why is this more infectious than previous outbreaks, which are isolated events in Congo and other parts of East Africa? Got much more densely populated parts of West Africa and large population centers like Monrovia. And furthermore, Peter Jarling, who's one of my former bosses at USAM, with the isolates they've gotten and tested there at the NIH, it seems to be replicated in a much higher titer. So rather than having 5 logs of virus per cc of blood, 7 logs of virus per cc of blood. So literally that's 100-fold more infectivity of any body fluid that caregivers are coming in contact with. So that may be an important component virologically what's different about this outbreak besides being in population centers as it was before. As far as treatment, it's supportive care, it's intensive care if people are going to have a chance of surviving. For the most part, there's been a lot of excitement. The doctor that survived that went to Emory, he's been donating his plasma to everybody. I think they're unlikely to hurt people giving his plasma, but in controlled studies, which is an important proviso in animals where you challenge them with Ebola, passive immunoprophylaxis, that is giving them antibody beforehand, really doesn't have any impact upon mortality. So beware. I mean, in a desperate circumstance, you do what you can do, but I wouldn't invest my retirement plan in passive immunoprophylaxis for Ebola. And I probably wouldn't invest in a vaccine either, a significant amount of money, although I think it's an interesting prospect, because you can overcome most any severe infectious challenge with a high titer dose challenge. So you have to have aggregate immunity to really protect people. And so yes, there are a couple of vaccines in development. But when I say development, they are way, way in baby development, phase 1 and 2. They're nowhere close to the phase 3 trial. I think they're supposed to ramp it up as fast as they can this summer in West Africa. Questions, comments, or rebuttals? You don't want it. And the big and heartburn, as you can tell by the people to my left and talk about it, is it's only a plane ride away. That's what Presbyterian Hospital in Dallas found out. It's not like they asked for that patient. You just land on their doorstep. And are you going to be able to sort through 100,000 visits at Mission Hospital every year and make sure you've screened out somebody who's been in contact with an Ebola patient and not absolutely wrap your medical system around one patient? And that's what's happened to Presbyterian Hospital in Dallas. It's basically just completely turned them upside down and put them in gridlock and taking care of the thousands of other patients normally they would serve. We really like to avoid that.
All right, so I'm going to talk a little bit about, kind of take a more broader view about the role of public health and preparedness and in meeting challenges like Ebola. So we know that public health threats are always present. Ebola isn't the first one and it won't be the last one. And being prepared to prevent, respond to, and recover from these threats is critical for protecting the health of the public. And an effective public health response begins with the local response. And the ability to conduct routine public health activities. And so the role of public health is preparing for and organizing responses to emergencies. And while the preparedness and planning can't eliminate the threats, through coordinated community-wide planning for emergency medical and public health responses, we assure that we have the necessary services available and deployed in a rapid and effective manner. And local health departments have plans in place for disease outbreaks and natural disasters. And the plans are adaptable to the specific situation, like Ebola. And planning for the coordinated responses involves monitoring the available resources, establishing protocols, simulating emergency events through tabletop exercises or full-scale exercises to improve our readiness, training personnel, assessing communication capabilities, supplies and resources, and then building and maintaining relationships with partner organizations like you see here to improve coordination. And in order to manage the resources effectively and facilitate decision-making during outbreaks or emergencies, we use something called the Incident Command System, and our partners use this as well. It's very common in emergency management in hospitals. And we have, at Health and Human Services, we have implemented our incident command system, focusing currently on our planning and logistics phases. And it's a standardized management tool that is used to meet the demands of any situation. It could be an emergency situation, it could be a non-emergency situation, like a large concert or festival. It could be a small incident, like a car accident, or a very large incident, like a public health outbreak. And in managing incidents, there are clear goals and objectives that are established. They're communicated to all the responders. We have the response plans that are utilized, effective communications, and our resources are utilized in a timely and effective manner. And it's a structure that helps eliminate a lot of the common problems related to communication, terminology, like in the medical field, you know, an abbreviation might be one thing and it could be a totally different thing in the world of emergency management. So we use a common language to communicate. We have an organizational structure that everybody understands and a sort of span of control. And it just helps make the situation handled in a more effective and efficient manner. And so public health, we are a first responder to a wide variety of health threats, many of which we don't hear about on the evening news. Our communicable disease nurses are specially trained in disease investigation and response. And, you know, a routine day for them would involve, you know, a phone call from a concerned citizen that she and her family got sick after they ate at a restaurant. Or it would be receiving faxes from local medical providers who are reporting communicable diseases like pertussis. Or it could be a call from a long-term facility reporting that they're seeing a lot of diarrhea in their residents and staff. So on a day-to-day basis, they're constantly getting this information and investigating these threats. And we also have specially trained environmental health staff who are helping protect against and monitor health threats by restaurant inspections, septic permitting, well water testing, tattoo parlor permitting. So this is something our staff are routinely involved in. And we have to have the capacity, though, to not only to respond to these routine day-to-day disease reports or larger community outbreaks of communicable diseases, foodborne disease, natural disasters, but also the capacity to respond to major events like a pandemic flu or a terrorist attack. And during a public health emergency, it's our role as the local health department, it's our role to communicate with the public so that the community knows what's going on and what they need to do to protect themselves. We utilize our connections with our community partners like you see here, so hospitals, local medical providers, emergency management, schools and universities, the faith community, to share guidance on how to detect and manage cases and to ensure that everybody understands their role and that plans are followed. We do receive support from state and federal agencies, so North Carolina Division of Public Health, the CDC. They help develop and disseminate recommendations that then we push out to the local community, the local clinicians and labs to make sure that they know what to do. And our staff has been recently, you know, lots of conference calls, lots of webinars, lots of meetings from the State Division of Public Health, from the CDC, and we're constantly reviewing the guidance and then again pushing it out to our local medical community. And we rely on our agency and our community surge capacity to ensure that we have enough resources if we need it. So we may utilize our school nurses to help with investigations. And during the 2004 flooding, our environmental health staff got helped out by some of our nursing staff to go into restaurants to make sure that they had water supplies. And so specifically about our communicable disease program, you know, they're the ones who really provide the surveillance, the investigation necessary to control communicable diseases and to protect the health of the public. Being effectively prepared and able to respond really relies on monitoring disease patterns, investigating all those individual case reports that come in, using epidemiological and lab analysis to make sure that we get the true picture of what's going on. And we really rely on our local medical community to promptly communicate with us, well, recognize and then communicate with us any cases of communicable disease that they see. And while the providers are seeing an individual, we are able to get through all that information, we can get a more population perspective and see, oh, what is the true picture of what's going on in the community? This isn't just one case of pertussis. Wow, we're seeing a lot of pertussis in our community. And then we're able to feed that back out to the local providers so they know that, yeah, we're seeing an increase. Here's what we need you to do to help us shut this down. Our disease control staff, they're really disease detectives. You know, and they're specially trained, and they When we have a report or we're investigating an outbreak, they follow the same steps no matter what it is. If it's pertussis or it's Ebola, they're going to follow the same steps during an outbreak investigation. And that's critical to make sure they don't miss anything. They're going to be contacting patients. They're going to be obtaining detailed information on, you know, where they've been, what they've been doing, who they've been in contact with. They're going to make sure that we have the clinical specimens, you know, the blood, whatever the specimen is we need to run appropriate tests, or they're going to make sure we have environmental samplings, you know, if it's a foodborne outbreak, you know, make sure we get the food that we're concerned about, get that tested. And state statute gives us as a public health agency the ability to access medical records related to any outbreak. And we utilize our connections at the hospital, the infection prevention staff, our public health epidemiologists there to make sure that we have all the information we need. You know, based on the answers to these questions, it really informs our effort, our efforts to mount a rapid and effective intervention. And our role in dealing with Ebola, should it arise, really will be in this sort of investigation piece. We'll be identifying, interviewing, and actively monitoring contacts, which is called contact tracing. We won't be involved in the treatment of sick individuals. We'll leave that to the doctors at the hospital. Right now what that would involve is it checking in twice a day with someone who's been a contact to a person with Ebola who might have been exposed for 21 days to check them for symptoms and their temperature monitoring. And then control measures is a big piece of what health departments will do. So routinely, our communicable disease staff issues control measures to persons who are diagnosed with certain communicable diseases like hepatitis or HIV or TB. And the control measures are to make sure they are aware of their disease state and the behaviors and activities they should not do to prevent the spread of their infection. So, for example, if we had a food handler who is diagnosed with Shigella, we issue him control measures saying you cannot return to work until you have proven to us that you are no longer infectious. And the point of that is to prevent the spread of that illness in our community. And under North Carolina general statute, the local health director has the authority to take action to control diseases that are threats to public health. So we have the ability to use isolation, and isolation is when you separate sick people with a contagious disease from people who are not sick, and again, in an effort to stop the spread of disease. And then we also have the ability to use quarantine, which is when you separate and restrict the movement of people who, while they're not sick yet, were exposed to a contagious disease and could become sick. And so the decision to issue these isolation or quarantine orders is very serious, and you have to take into consideration individual rights in the health of the public. The statute says, you know, quarantine and isolation authority shall be exercised only when and so long as the public health is endangered. All other reasonable means for correcting the problem have been exhausted, and no less restrictive alternative exists. So, I mean, it's a very specific standard that we have to meet. And typically, you know, if someone is sick or infected or has been exposed to a communicable disease, they're going to voluntarily comply with our instructions. But if they don't, the local health director does have the ability to involuntarily detain these individuals for the purposes of isolation and quarantine. And under state statute, someone who fails to comply with isolation or quarantine orders that can be prosecuted for a misdemeanor offense and can be sentenced to up to 2 years in prison. And we hope we never get to that point. And we work closely with the county attorney, with DA's office, with the clerk of courts, with the magistrate's office, and with law enforcement as needed throughout this process. And we definitely, you know, if we got to the point of something very serious like Ebola, we would definitely have the state health officials involved as well. And so that's kind of just the broader view of what public health does in these sort of situations. Any questions for me? Does that cover everything okay?
I have one question. It's about cross-county communication, because being in healthcare, I've seen situations where we would have certain individuals with infectious diseases, and Buncombe County would summon, you know, pretty robust
effort. The other counties would be doing that, but then there would be some breakdown sometimes. A family member drifted into another community where it wasn't really clear who's communicating, who's owning, who's in charge of that. So I just think, are there any regional efforts around coordination of communication across the county health directors and county medical directors for each county?
Right. So, from a medical director perspective, we have begun to, as a state, kind of get more connected. I definitely, I have a huge email list that I send out to providers and basically local medical community, and I know that I have the medical directors in the counties around ours involved in that, and I know that the communicable disease nurses are pretty well, if they have any inkling that there's something going along, around county borders, they're pretty good about picking up the phone and contacting their colleagues. And the state, they send out their, if there was something, I think regionally, I think the state would probably get involved and make sure that there was more regional communication. I'm not sure about health director, Gibby, what regionally, how you guys would communicate.
We communicate on lots of different issues, so there's a lot of experience with doing that. In addition to that, we have the Health Alert Network. It's a statewide network where when there are issues in a particular county, that goes out on the network, and calls come in, so you start getting information. Unfortunately, sometimes we do have breakdown. They're dealing with a particular issue in a county, and that they haven't quite put all the pieces together about whether that person is connected with somebody in another county. Sometimes that falls through the cracks, so we're really working to prevent that from happening as we move forward.
And I think it all comes back to, again, that disease investigation skills of the communicable disease staff, and really having well-trained staff, experienced staff, who know what questions to ask and know, how far to pursue things.
Well, to follow up on that question, do our smaller counties have the health departments they need to respond to something like this? Or is it going to be incumbent on Buncombe County to protect the whole region?
This is, from a public health perspective, I won't speak for Mission or anybody else, but from a public health perspective, we have a requirement for every county in this state to be prepared to address these sorts of issues. Obviously, the resources and the infrastructure in every county is going to vary, and smaller counties is a bit more challenging. But they all have communicable disease staff. One of the benefits we have is that we have regional communicable disease staff that work for the state that can back that staff up in those smaller counties. We also have a regional team of state staff. They used to be county staff for Buncombe for the region, but now they're state staff, who also have expertise in addressing outbreaks and those sorts of things. So there are resources that they can pull on, so it doesn't necessarily have to be Buncombe County. When we're working across counties with issues, we're obviously going to be interfacing with them. And what we see sometimes when we're doing that is they pull on us for our fact sheets and other kinds of information. They just don't have the capacity to turn out the way we do.
Thank you.
So now we're gonna have some of our community partners talk about their role in preparing for situations like Ebola. So I'm gonna pass it off to Dr. DeRienzo.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mullendore. And I wanted to also thank the chair and the board for inviting us to be here today, as well as our local elected leadership for their presence. I think that the board has clearly identified this as an important issue in our community. And I think it's very timely that we have a chance to sit together, review our plans, and allow the community to know what's going on. I'd like to really focus the comments from a mission side around three areas this morning, and then we'll be very happy to entertain questions at the end as well. The three areas really are planning, preparation, and partnership. And so at Mission, we've been planning now for the potential of a patient with suspected or confirmed Ebola for a number of months. Back in early August, we convened a multidisciplinary team, including representatives from our infectious diseases group, emergency medicine, infection prevention, hospital leadership, our public health liaison, emergency services, and so forth, to begin these planning efforts. And I'd like to highlight this morning really one of our first efforts was building in the kind of comprehensive screening tool which would allow our caregivers to make a positive identification of a patient with suspected Ebola. And so for almost a month now, we've had built into our electronic medical record system a screening tool that works its way through a series of questions to help someone who's triaging a patient identify, is this patient really at risk of a travel-related communicable disease? And the way we built this alert is such that it not only would help a caregiver identify Ebola, but would also be applicable to any future potential travel-related diseases we may see by admission. So for example, MERS-CoV or SARS or a measles epidemic. The same series of questions will really allow that caregiver to make an identification of a potential travel-related disease. If it is positive, in other words, if that alert pops up, it directs that caregiver to apply a face mask to the patient, explain to them really what's going on and why we're concerned, put them in an isolated room, and then any one who's with them actually is isolated separately in a separate room. And then contact is made with our 24/7 infection prevention team. And that's run by Jacie. And so Jacie's team can then run through the case definition, in this case for Ebola, or any other potential diseases that may come down the line, and direct that caregiver as to what the right next step is. If it's reassurance, which so far we've been able to provide reassurance, or if there are additional steps that need to be taken. So that screening is live within our electronic medical record system, everywhere we have that particular product. It is a paper form everywhere we don't have that product, and then we're building it into every EMR system that our IT team can get it into, such that in ambulatory, radiology, urgent care centers, emergency department, anywhere we touch patients, and patients touch us, we'll have that screening done. And that is the broadest suite that really we can make. The preparation efforts, I'd also like to touch on. Much like the county, we've activated our Incident Command Center. I lead that group in addition to one of our nursing leaders. We're the unified command, Kristen's Jared Becker. JC and Ned Fowler serve on that leadership team as well. And right now we're having daily check-ins as we run down the same branches as you've heard from my colleagues at HHS, operations, logistics, planning, and so forth. A lot of the work of that group has really been around securing the right personal protective equipment. And as we've all seen on the news, that's been a moving target from CDC, but we've set the bar very high for ourselves in terms of educating, training, and protecting our caregivers and providing the level C PPE that you've seen come out of the Nebraska Containment Unit. Training is underway. We have master trainers who've undergone that, volunteers from around the hospital. And then to the question about our system, we're bringing in members of the emergency department from each of Mission Health's entities in order to ensure that they have the same degree of training and preparation to put on that level C PPE. Those who have seen JC don that on the news can attest now that it's not easy to put on, and it's even harder to take off. And so much of our efforts are focused not only on the initial training, recognizing that if you go through a 1 hour, a 3 hour, an 8 hour session, your ability to retain that is not going to be 100%, no matter how much time we spend trying to put you through it the first time. And so one of, I think, the most important parts of our PPE training is the just-in-time refresher, which we would put every caregiver through immediately before they take care of a patient. And then as a corollary to that, we would have a monitor as well as a buddy. And so what you saw in the news, I would have been the analog of JC's buddy. So that person is also dressed in full PPE and helps with the doffing procedure. But as you can imagine, taking that suit off by yourself is really just not tenable. And then having a monitor who's also present running the checklist to make sure that you've gone step by step, both in the donning, sort of the putting on, as well as the doffing, so the taking off. CDC's guidance now is really that having the training, having the practice, and then having this sort of monitoring system is the best that we believe we can do to provide the safest potential environment for our caregivers to take care of these extraordinarily sick patients. And I'd like to emphasize what David mentioned. When these patients present, we haven't seen a lot of viral hemorrhagic fever in the United States. Now, those who've been doing this for a while can attest, these are not particularly common illnesses, but these patients are losing liters upon liters of fluid a day. They are critically and intensively ill. And so they need to be cared for in a hospital environment that can provide that degree of critical and intensive care. And so that really brings us to my final point, which is around partnership. So early on in this process, I think we've identified that no single individual can really take care of an evolving patient alone. It takes really a community for us to be able to care for these patients. We've seen that in Emory. You can see it happening now in New York. And so we've worked on these partnerships, especially with the Department of Public Health. And we're very grateful for the kind of back and forth that we can provide in terms of information sharing, as well as support when the time comes. So representatives from that group have been coming to our meetings, and we're very excited that we're here today and attending yours as well. The partnership, I think, extends from the broader community within the hospital as well. So when you're caring for a patient with Ebola, the potential for different places they can touch your system is quite broad. So we've planned what is the route that we would take a patient from the emergency department through the minimum number of corridors up into the designated area that we've prepared for it. What's the right transport service to be able to bring that patient from wherever it is they may present to Mission Hospital, which would be our health system's designated location to treat a patient like this? How are we going to ensure that those open lines of communication remain with the county, with the State Department of Public Health, and ultimately with CDC? Because I think you're now seeing how CDC is envisioning its response to any patient who turns positive for Ebola materializing in New York, with the confirmatory screen going back, with CDC response team being on site there, helping the hospital prepare. We've done a number of these internal preparations ourselves in terms of what the room looks like, ensuring we have the dedicated fail-safe outlets for the lab equipment to be set up directly in the patient's room, training for the caregivers who would be performing those lab tests. How are we going to dispose of the waste? What are we going to do in terms of the remainder of that unit? So it takes many different partnerships within the hospital, across our health system, and then within the community to make this kind of planning happen. So to that final point, I've just been very grateful to be part of that process, see the kind of open discussions that happen within this community and within Mission Health. I'm very proud to be part of Mission Health, and seeing our caregivers go through this training and the commitment that they really have to providing the best possible care we can for the patient, as well as the safest possible care for our community. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to the rest of the panel, and Jacie and I are here to answer questions as well.
Okay, recently, 2 weeks ago, or I guess 3 weeks ago, this panel met at the Asheville Regional Airport. I think most of us were there and discussed what had been going on already by Mission Hospital, the train. And until last night, we thought we were over the hump of this nation being free of any viruses that might come to the United States. So we were proven wrong last night. I think the ICS system is what was mentioned here earlier. And that's what we are on as a fire service and a police service and a Mission Hospital. When there is something that occurs in this area, we will all meet together and we will all be ready. Because I think Buncombe County and the surrounding Western North Carolina is ready for this, especially Mission Hospital. Mission Hospital has done wonderful things already to start this process for us in the medical field. I think this unfortunate virus has given all of us first responders time to relook at our equipment out there in first response area, to look at stuff that has never been used and has been on trucks for years that we need to replace. And that is occurring to this day. I left the station this morning with hoods and suits and the stuff that you see on TV every day where they're treating an Ebola patient. It was sitting in the office out there ready to be put on our trucks. I think one thing we have to be careful about is that when we're out there as a first responder community, is our folks have been cautioned about using Ebola, the term Ebola, the name, because we respond to some of the symptoms we respond to every day. fever, weakness, headache, vomiting, diarrhea. And then with the flu season coming on, that's going to put things in folks' mind that Ebola will be here next week. And we have to be careful about this getting out in first responder area and alarming this community. At this meeting 3 weeks ago, Representative Moffitt, he called. We talked about, well, maybe we won't have to worry about it because it's not on the East Coast. Well, last night proved us wrong again. The East Coast is in New York. We heard this morning that the gentleman rode the subway, he rode a taxi, and then went bowling. Now, I would imagine that New York City is very in tune to those folks up there, and those folks are asking, did I go where he was at? Because one of the things that we have a four-page document from North Carolina OMS that has changed. This is our third document that we've had in 3 weeks. And I think Stacy's got this ready to prove for first responders, is that it's changing, but it's changing for the better. It's informing us that we're learning more about this and what more we can do every single day to train better for this. But the first part in red is immediate concern. Travelers from an area with Ebola outbreak can arrive in North Carolina prior to exhibiting symptoms and becoming ill here. So one of the questions on here, have you been to Africa in the last 21 days? We hope we never see, have you been to New York City in the last 21 days? But that could be coming. It could be coming, and we have to be ready for that. And I think Buncombe County is ready. Probably one of the most significant areas that we may deal with is Chief Smith here from the airport. And as first responders, we have to be ready for that. We are. Buncombe County EMS is on top of this, along with the fire department response teams. And we're training. We're looking at who's gonna be the first initial on the scene. We may go to a person's house, and it's probably going to cause a whole lot more concern this time around for the flu than if not, because of what is going on in the nation today. So we hope we learn more about the New York incident in the next couple of days. If it does turn out that there's a second patient infected from whatever way, then I can assure you that this panel is going to meet again in a very quick way to change what we're going to do on the scenes. So I think everything has been covered here by the folks at the health department and the hospital, and I'm going to let Chief Smith talk about the airport. But I just want people to know that Buncombe County is ready. We're going to get even more ready as time goes on, and just sit back and pray that we don't have to use our equipment.
Having me. One of the concerns that people have when they hear the word airport in relation to this is being on that aircraft with a sick person. What they don't seem to keep in mind is typically that aircraft is going to land and that sick person is going to leave before we ever know they were sick. And we're not going to be dealing with it. Airports across the country have been receiving updates from the CDC and from different health organizations throughout this particular event. On a local level, as Chief Presley says, we have been meeting. We keep a fully trained emergency response team at the airport 24 hours a day. We train with Skyland Fire Department. In fact, we'll be training with Asheville Fire Department this afternoon. It's ongoing with our neighboring departments. We realize that as these people come into the airport, should someone be infected, we're probably not going to interact with them. It's probably going to be from an investigating standpoint after we find out they're ill. As the first gentleman said, the original patient, patient zero, lied to get into the country. He didn't stop at the airport once he got to his final destination and said, oh, okay, I'm sick now. And we know that it's going to be a lot of backtracking from an aviation standpoint. Should a person get violently sick on a flight coming into Asheville, we are not an international airport. Most of our flights into the airport are of short duration, so they've probably only been in the air for about an hour, 2 hours. We have forms that have been provided by the CDC to hand out to every passenger on that plane that has not only a fact sheet of what to kind of monitor yourself for, but it also gives us their location. And we have them fill them out so we have to isolate the plane. Those forms are made available to first responders, but we're not passing them out unless we have a reason to be very, very, very concerned. And at that point, we're already working with local emergency medical services, the health department, et cetera, at the point in time we've had to isolate an airplane. The chances of that happening are extremely remote. For someone who just has been on a plane, those planes go right back out. So it becomes an investigative process if we do not find out that they've been exposed until well after they've flown into the airport. The forms we're using have been handed out by CDC. They are in use at international airports, particularly the 5 target airports. If you're traveling from the countries in Africa affected, you're required to enter the U.S. through 5 specific airports where you undergo a health screening at that time. So for someone to fly into Asheville with it, they got to clear there first, and they get violently ill in the 1 hour flight from there to Asheville. So we really consider that very low risk. We continue our training with EMS. We continue our activity on panels such as this so that we can be ready. But I'd like to reiterate what Chief Presley said. We've been training in this in the emergency management field for years. We are constantly learning, we're adjusting, but I agree that we are very well prepared at this point, we feel, to handle what comes our way, and we're trying to make all the necessary preparations. Thank you.
I'm Jennifer Johnson, the Public Information Officer for Buncombe County Human Services. And in preparation for a possible Ebola outbreak or a confirmed case here, could be a very low risk for that, but in just in case, we will be utilizing rapid communication systems that are in place with stakeholders in our community, and those groups include our local and state officials. Our Health and Human Services staff will keep them up to date and informed. We have an epidemiology team, and on that team sits our public health leaders and Mission Hospital's epidemiologist, Dr. David Buehner, and Buncombe County Emergency Management. We also have a public outreach information team or point team, and Jerry Jameson with Mission Hospital, she sits on that group as well. And it also includes other public information officers from organizations in Buncombe County that typically handle emergency situations. And communicating with this group is going to be key in our community organizations having unified voice to the public and the community. And then also will help to reduce misinformation that may be out there about Ebola. We also will be communicating, of course, with the media, and that will be with major news organizations in our area and radio stations, the Western Carolina Medical Society, Asheville City and Buncombe County Schools, Buncombe County Contractors, and Beacon, which is the Buncombe Emergency Assistance Network, and that includes organizations such as the Salvation Army, United Way, Council on Aging, and ABCCM, which does outreach to the faith-based communities. We will also do outreach to the Vulnerable Populations Initiative, and with the help of that will be with the help of emergency management. They were previously participating with VPI, Vulnerable Populations Initiative, and they are now looking at the possibility of leading that group in order to get information out to those vulnerable populations, which could include people with disabilities, seniors, those with limited English proficiency, and the medically dependent or others with special needs in the community. We would also do other outreach to agencies in the community that are deemed appropriate for assisting with this type of possible emergency, and those who have well-established relationships with the community at large. Some of the ways that we would provide emergency information to these groups would be through news advisories and updates on our website, and we can also ask our partners to share information on their websites. We have printed fact sheets, and we could do emails to distribution lists, pre-recorded messaging, through voice
broadcasting systems to phone contacts and mass text messaging, hotline messages, and of course we will utilize social media. There will be other ways that we can get information out to partners in the community, and we can also provide scripts to our greeters and front desk staff who would, you know, come in contact with someone on the phone or in person if they come in and say that they have traveled to an area that's been affected by Ebola or have been exposed to someone with Ebola. To stay informed, as Dr. Mullendore says, we receive updated information from the CDC and the state via conference calls and emails. And currently the state has an Ebola public information line, and if that is through the Carolinas Poison Center. And we have that number up on our website, and as well as a news article with resources such as Ebola fact sheets. One of our roles is to develop and provide those fact sheets and to our community partners, and our fact sheet and infographic handout are included. They're at your desk or in your packet. And with those fact sheets, we try to address misinformation, like how Ebola is actually spread and transmitted, and provide the ways that you can protect yourself from exposure, not only to Ebola, but other common types of communicable diseases that people are more likely to come into contact with. And some of those ways would be, of course, to get immunized. And if you haven't gotten your flu shot, they're providing flu shots right here at the store. And of course, frequent hand washing would be another big way to prevent the spread of communicable disease. The infographic that you have, it provides information about levels of exposure and informs the reader to stay calm and when someone should be concerned enough to contact our disease control department. And if you would like more copies of these, you can get with me after this meeting and I will make sure I get those to you if you would like to share those with your organizations, or I can send them via email. The point team with the PIOs from other organizations, we are scheduled to meet November the 6th, and we will continue this conversation around preparedness and how we'll get information out with a unified voice into the community just in case an Ebola, you know, confirmed case were to happen in our area. I will not be alone in getting this done, as I'm on a team of fantastic communication professionals, including Stacy Wood, who's back over here. She's our backup PIO. Stacy, is she with us? Okay.
Hi,
Stacy. And Ben Atkins, he is our communication and design specialist, and they will be working with me in case this happens to get information out rapidly to the community. Thank you so much for your time.
All right, Jennifer. So as you can see, a pretty common thread through everything was that we're not in our silos, that we're, you know, no single entity is the only one working on this issue, that it takes all of us to take care of the health of the public. And so, you know, this is not the first time we met, this won't be the last time we meet probably. Our preparedness is an ongoing effort, and the threats, you know, will just keep coming. And, you know, communication is very key to all of this. And again, you know, there is that reactive, that responsive phase, but again, it's preparation, it's prevention, it's, you know, trying to do all we can so that our community is safe and doesn't have to deal with the threats coming to life. And so now, you know, we have time for discussion. If anybody has any questions, feel free to ask.
I personally would like to thank the board members, the panel brothers, for being here and providing us with this. It's very evident that there has been a plan in place. And it's all you've done is add Ebola to it with different things involved with it. And I think it's great to know that you're spending so much time with each other so that if and when something happens, that we're ready to go. And to me, it's very evident that you are. One of the things, Chief, that I was, when I listened to you, indicated you had equipment that was on the truck and whatnot that had never been used and so forth. What type of situation do you go through the check to see if it's
field and check them, see if they're working. But you know, it's those that have been on the truck and doesn't have a shelf life in some of the suits. You just leave them on there and see how old they are. And we're talking about a couple of years old, or 3 years old for some of the suits, because they do have the wear and tear when you move them in and out of the unit itself. But it's all being replaced by better equipment, better enclosed equipment with the hoods and the entire stuff that you see on TV. That's the real life. So it's just giving us that opportunity to get better.
Well, I can see where it would be of interest that it's appropriate, and because of what happened to the nurses, as to how they got infected, we don't know. But anyway, glad to know that you got the matter in hand. Anyone else have any questions they'd like to ask?
How long does it take a person to fully recover?
It depends how ill you get as far as that multi-organ system dysfunction. I would be very conservative to say you'd be in the ICU anywhere from 1 to 2 weeks. Then you'd be weak as water, and it would take another month of rehab if you survive.
Right. Yes, sir.
Jennifer, can you tell me, who did you say is taking the lead on the notification to the vulnerable populations?
Emergency management.
Can you tell me if there's a special emphasis on those non-majority populations, particularly ethnic and racial minorities, mainly because historically speaking, these are people who are adversely affected, but also are last to be notified, are properly informed?
So we have a minority health coordinator on the Atkins, and she has access to distribution lists that reach the African American community. Mm-hmm. And then we also communicate through Lavage, which communicates, it's a newspaper that communicates to the Latino population, or Spanish-speaking population. And there are some other ways to communicate with those populations as well.
So Ms. Atkins is the one that will communicate to the Hispanic population, so
she will communicate.
She has her contact.
She has a distribution list that communicates to people within the African American community.
Sharon, that's an ongoing group, and if you have ideas about people who need to be added to that, as Red Cross took the lead, the KMS has taken a much more assertive role in the lead going forward. So let us know.
I have a comment, not so much to the panel, it's actually to Suzanne. being a parent of an elementary school child, it has been interesting to see that anxiety level in schools. I wonder if you're beginning to have any issues. I just think, you know, we try to keep our children away from some of the negative media, but it definitely has been coming home weekly. Had interesting conversations that I never thought I'd be having with an 11-year-old about not only Ebola, but enterovirus, and what's the difference, and where is it, and who's affected, and it's just fascinating to me how that spreads.
It does spread, and I think our students are often in the center of these kinds of things more than we wish them to be. I think counselors are key in that, and having structures to have conversations and sending those conversations home to the families. So those can be addressed. I haven't heard of heightened conversation this week. We had a few other things going on in the district. It's a good time for fall break, so Monday.
It is
Tuesday,
a good time.
Absolutely. It's a good time.
Any other question?
I just wanted to follow up with what you were asking that we do have translators available to translate any materials that we develop, Spanish and Russian. Those are typically the languages that are spoken in our community, besides English, Russian, and Spanish. So any materials that we develop, we definitely have translated
know Senator Van Dyne for Commissioner Belcher to be grateful for the support of public health and understanding the importance of doing that as that core function only government can provide in partnership with others. And no, you'll be an advocate in Raleigh, and that you're an advocate upstairs.
Absolutely.
So thank you both.
Since you said that, I do want to thank you for doing this. There has been, through schools, through kids, through church, through just different people that you run into, there have been questions, there have been concerns, you know, it's all over Facebook, you know, every time a plane lands and somebody's got a nosebleed or, you know, I mean, just people are just going crazy. But I want to publicly thank Mission, EMS, Air Force, Health and Human Services for what you do. I have a lot of confidence in you, and I'm not the only person out there that does. So as you continue to improve and you continue to meet a lot of bad news when you pick the paper up. You know, it'd be good for people to know that this is ongoing. These are things that we're doing. You can feel safe and secure at home. We should let people know that as often as we can to assure those children that are in school and others that might have concerns. Thank you.
Well, and I'll just very briefly say I'm just glad I live in Buncombe County.
We're glad you did too.
We're nice to be.
We'd love if y'all would like to remain with us if you feel like you'll be fascinated by Jim's financial reports. Except for Dr. McClain.
It's the highlight of every meeting.
If the rest of you want to use the opportunity to grab a banana pudding and go, we really do thank you both for the partnership day in and day out. Chief Presley made a point that's proven true for us too, is it is beyond having the plans and buying the equipment once, but making sure you have the audit procedures so you know you're replacing them in a timely way. And I think we're all using this as an opportunity to make sure we have those consistent plans. So, Chief.
I kept trying to figure out a way I could have a selfie with them, but I couldn't figure out how to do it. We need to approve the minutes from the last board meeting. We've all had a chance to see them. Have any questions pertaining to the minutes? If not, do I have a motion that we accept them as presented?
Move.
Second. Any question? All those in favor say aye. Thank you. Now, Jim.
Good afternoon. Quickly to look at the financials, we're looking at the period ended September 30th. We're 25% through the fiscal year. And happy to report that you'll see, if we look at DSS first, if we look by area, you'll see the line that's across the graph here that shows that we're all of our spending is under, at, or below the 25%, with the exception of contracts. And remember, as we've said before, We prepay some of those contracts so that our contractors have the funds to be able to provide those services that we contract for. So some of those are prepaid, and that's why we're there. If you look by function or by accounting unit, you'll see there's one area that's above the 25% mark, and that's administration, and that's the reasons that we've talked about before for prepayment of workers' compensation and unemployment insurance that we pay for the entire year. And that's a large amount of money, and that puts us over. And we'll see that that part of the reason for the costs will track down over the next 12 or the remainder of 9 months. Other than that, we're right on target with where we should be, and where spending is lower is in emergency assistance. That's simply because we're not in the peak of our emergency assistance season, particularly with the weather. As we get colder weather, that will go up, and we'll be seeing our expenditures rise in that area as well. You know that we contract out those services. So. Happy to answer any questions that you might have about the DSS expenditures. Okay, we'll take a look at the...
One question.
Yes, sir.
Have things that spike something, is there a way to, you know, like if you should just go down to the bottom and pull out the things that cause it to spike and show that your administrative is underlined or on course so that you don't have to wait till the end of the year for those spikes to level out when you're looking at it. But just a thought.
We can certainly make sure that we do that. Thank you. So if we look at health, the same situation, we're 25% through the fiscal year. And if you look by area, salaries, operatings, and contracts, you'll see we're at or below the 25% through the course of the year, which tracks, as you see the mountain background behind there, tracks with where our typical spending is for this time of year. If you look by accounting unit, again, the same thing. We're tracking closely to where we were last year at this time. And again, with the administration costs, that's because we prepay those premiums for unemployment and workers' compensation. Other than that, if you look again at the figures, we're right on track of where we should be and where we anticipate that we'll be staying for the rest of the fiscal year. I'm happy to answer any questions about the health expenditures, and thank you. We'll make a note of that. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
On the advisory committee report, because of the time that anyone of these reports has something we need to tell or need to pass or something on for the board, assuming that so, then we'll go through Mandy Stone and her report.
I'm really going to be very quick because we figured we'd have limited time today and tell you that. We have many challenges. We've talked about those both in exec committee and here related to staffing and environmental health and some of the peaks and how we're addressing those. I want to take a minute to welcome Jessica Silvers, who comes to us from Warren County and is the program manager in environmental health. We're really thrilled to have her. From an environment where they were also physically located with permits and inspection and planning as they are here. Lots of effort in that interview process, which Gibby led, along with Matt Stone from Permits and Inspections, to build a shared quality improvement, continuous improvement team across permits and inspection, planning, and environmental health. So we're thrilled to have her here. And although she says she's hanging on by her fingernails, she's hanging on. So. And she really did come at a challenging time, and we appreciate that. Working through. Still, some of our state funding, we had the conversation on a state level this week that where we used to simply wait for state allocations, now we are much more impacted by the rules that get written on administrative level around those state dollars, not just what the General Assembly passes. And one of the areas we're seeing the greatest impact is child care subsidy. We have some estimates on those numbers, but we'll share those with the board. You know, it significantly will impact who's eligible for child care subsidy, particularly in the after school arena. So we want to watch that. The other is NC FAS. You all enjoyed the fun ride of food and nutrition in NC FAS, and we are now in the Medicaid world. And for Buncombe County, for Philip and his team who are here, that means there were about 12,000 Medicaid recipients who we have to complete their recertification by December 31st, or they will lose their eligibility. We are down to under 10,000 today. We've been working on it since they converted a couple of weeks ago. Have very targeted plans. all of staff and all of leadership see at the end of every day where we are on that plan. We're targeted to complete that work, we hope, by December 15th. Hired many temporary staff. Are in the process of identifying what permanent staff we're going to need to take to commissioners in November. Continues to be a challenge. What happens, although it sounds simple, when North Carolina moved to this automated system, the cases that convert from the old system to the new system, all the information does not convert. So Trish or anybody on that side can offer lots more detail, but the dummy version that I can offer you is they have to, that it takes about an hour and a half, 2 hours to fix that information, convert it into the new system, close it, then reopen it, and then 25 minutes to recertify. So about 3 hours for every one of those cases in terms of touch. Is that fair enough? That doesn't count the people who have multiple family members and complex assets and other pieces. But we are absolutely, as a staff and as a leadership, committed to get that work done. We are working basically teams between all the times that the system is up, which is 5 a.m. to 9 p.m. We basically have people at work at it, converting data, converting cases, closing cases, recertifying cases. We've worked with county attorney and county HR and Lisa's staff to allow supervisors to work overtime to help us with those recertifications too. I know they're thrilled about it.
Is NC Fast any better about being up because it had some real hardware glitches?
It might be better about being up more days than not. The challenge right now is the same thing you saw in FNS, and I tell you, I'm not criticizing the state, but project management is not necessarily proven to be their strength. What happens is we're the only urban that converted in the first round, so as more urbans convert, all that data gets dumped in the system on a weekend can cause many more problems. Is that a fair?
And as they do software updates on some weekends, they tend to have problems on Mondays at times too. The software updates tend to cause problems now. It's an ongoing issue. All 100 counties will be in for Medicaid purposes that year.
And Medicaid's one of those, we're probably about 85% of the statewide caseload sits in the 10 largest counties, and again, we were the only urban who converted the first round, so you're just beginning to see those numbers pile up, but hear us understand where we could wrap gift cards or food baskets around people who have FNS challenges. You're talking about people who every healthcare provider goes into the system, and that person would not be eligible for Medicaid. That's a whole different level of concern for the community and for those consumers, and we're all staying up at night worrying about it. But I feel like Philip and his team have done an amazing job putting together a plan. Jim and his team have done a great job of helping, and along with Lisa, find those resources, and Amy Davis has done a lot of that work. Be very creative about how we use some of those resources and how quickly we can bring them on the ground. We went from new employees starting who literally could wait weeks for a piece of equipment to a new system that Jim implemented where as they leave new orientation, they leave with their laptops and the things they need to do their job. So I think it's made us make shifts all across the system, but it's definitely most pressing for us. The other issue is space. I'm gonna talk about that real briefly. We have no space at COTS. We haven't had space at COTS. You know, twice that's been on the commissioner's agenda for a build and twice it's been delayed. We have staff literally working in hallways, in kitchens, on spaces not much bigger than a TV tray. Commissioners gave up their offices this week to help with some of that. So
I'm back in my car.
You see him riding around his car, left at him. And then we are negotiating lease space for two additional spaces on COTS, having to move all operations, HR, and finance out of the COTS building. It still will not be enough for us. So how we get through, not only right now, but if and when we do move into construction, will be a real challenge just because the volume that goes in and out of that space every day, both on the clinic side and the DSS side. And those are the issues that we are managing. Look, they still look happy with their job.
Thank you. Chris, do we have anybody sign up for public comment?
No, sir.
Krista needs to talk about November and December board schedule.
Right.
Both fall on a holiday.
So we're going to have the November board meeting on November 21st, which is the third Friday to the 4th. And then the December board meeting will be on December 19th, which will be the third.
And on the 21st, we are doing the safety net update, and I'll be sure and invite Dr. Widener back for that. But where we're hearing from Mayhack, Minnie Jones, Mission, all of our partners on how we're doing around that safety net indigent care.
That's which?
November.
Mandy, the special request I have is an emerging issue that keeps sort of percolating up out of that. And with the building of the complexities and connections within the safety net, there are new medication access issues that are popping up. Just, you know, it would be interesting to just kind of add that to what are some of the downstream impacts of some of the changes that we're seeing as we're adding, for example, as we're adding the new very innovative project with the Project 1300, we're going to get people into care, but then we don't exactly have all the medication access issues mapped out. And so just thinking about the ripple effect of systems when that happens. And just knowing that's happened before. It happens every time, you know, we move and change, and sometimes that treatment plan that includes access to medications doesn't always get brought to the forefront of discussion.
I think that's a great point. We may want to think about, in that meeting too, having some discussion, Jim, on the plans around 356 and that assessment center and access to the pharmacy through there and how you're building some of those pieces into group.
Yeah, when I heard you talk about delay in Medicaid approval, I just felt a ripple go through every retail pharmacy in town. Sometimes providers can figure out workarounds, but retail pharmacy systems are not set up for exceptions. So, is that a nice way to put
that?
They're
nice
not set up for exceptions.
We get the distance right on top of NC Tracks, which has created its share of challenges for them as well.
Yeah, you just made me have one more thing to keep me awake.
That's it for director's report and change in schedule.
Then I guess the chairperson's report. It was nice to see Dr. McClain take those dates down. I'm glad to see that. Other than that board meeting.
He's doing what we need him to do.
I said, I was glad to see you taking the days down when the next board is meeting in November, December.
It's the highlight of our.
All right. Now, as far as executive committee report, we heard what Jim gave, and we also heard what Mandy. The only thing I could add to it, we did get involved with the organizational setup that's going to change and so forth throughout the system. And anyway, that's basically all we had to report because you've already heard from them. Have any announcement or anything? Do I have a motion that we adjourn?
So move.
Second?
Second.
Move the second. All in favor, we'll see you.
All right.